Y'all see this beginning funky by that third day, bro. Y'all be coming up to me, "Preacher Tony, I just want the Lord to do a work in my heart." I'm like, "Brother, forget about the Bible. Here's some soap. Use it in Jesus' name." It's amazing. A million different odors. But listen, listen. Our sense of touch can detect a projection that's only 1/25,000th of an inch high. Dust. Who did that? Who created that? The Bible tells us in Proverbs chapter 20, verse 12, the seeing eye and the hearing ear, God created them both. Jesus made you. You're created by Jesus. And the Bible tells us in Ephesians chapter 10, 2 verse 10, that we are God's workmanship. That word means work of art. You are a priceless work of art. And listen, there is no other artist's work who can compare to your brilliance. You take all of them and go all the way back to the masters. You can go to the modern icons. They can't touch you. Go all the way back to Michelangelo. Go to Rembrandt. Go to Van Gogh. Go to Picasso. You can go to even William de Kooning and his work called The Interchange, which in September of 2015 sold for over $300 million. Man, I don't care. You can take all of the wealth of all of those artists and they can't come close to you, because you are a priceless treasure, original work of art made by Jesus. Amen. That's why he's such a big deal. He just happens to make living art, and you're an expression of his glory. He's our creator. He's not just our creator, he's also our sustainer. Did you see that in the text? This is so good, man. Check this out. It said this. Listen, this is beautiful. He upholds the universe by the word of his power. I was home one day and I was watching a scientific television program. They boasted that they hosted it with the most, what they called the brilliant minds on the planet. One of them was the infamous atheist, Dr. Richard Dawkins. The other was famed physicist, Stephen Hawking. I found what they had to say quite intriguing. They talked about a lot of stuff, but one of the things they talked about was the fact that our planet, the Earth, is tilted on its axis. This ball of mass you're sitting on right now, it happens to be tilted at a 23.5 degree angle. The experts said that it should not be tilted at a 23.5 degree angle because it's physically impossible due to the mass distribution of water weight on our globe. But they were glad that it's tilted at a 23.5 degree angle because it gives us our four seasons. And if it was not tilted at a 23.5 degree angle, they said, I didn't say it, they said the events that would unfold would be monstrously catastrophic. You might be out there right now looking at me with your arms folded like, "I don't need God. I don't need God." Come out! Oh, yes, you do. You need him to hold this world tilted at a 23.5 degree angle, brother. Amen. And you know what? He is holding it at a 23.5 degree angle, and he's not even breaking a sweat. What does that mean to all of us? It means that our Jesus, I'm trying to tell you who he is, he loves to operate in the realm of the impossible. So what does that mean to you when you're seated right now? Whatever you're going through, he can get you through. I'm trying to tell you who he is. He's our creator and he's our sustainer. But not just that, he's also our deliverer. Did you see that in the text? I haven't left my Bible. Listen to what it says. This is so beautiful. He made purifications for our sins and he sat down. What's going on in all of that? What's going on? Listen, when God created humanity, Adam and Eve, they did something that all of the other parts of creation couldn't do. They were made in the image of God. We bore the image of God. And so unlike anything else, we brought God a unique kind of glory. And God's got an arch enemy and his name is Satan. And Satan is a glory stealer. And so you know what he did? He slithered on over and he tempted Adam and Eve to do what God said not to do. And they sinned. They did what God said not to do. And when they did that, something shifted in our relationship with God. You see, before humanity sinned, they would hang with God. They would just hang with God. The Bible puts it this way, that God would walk with them in the garden in the cool of the day. They would just hang with God. After sin, they're not hanging with God anymore. They're hiding. covered up with leaves. And the question of God proves it all. Where are you? His heart is broken. Where are you? They were hiding. And you know what? We've been doing it ever since. The Bible says that we're all sinned and we've fallen short of the glory of God. And we're like sheep who go astray. And because of our sin, God could blow us away. But instead, he steps in and he saves the day. Saves the day. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, we hear the gospel preached for the very first time. It was preached by God to Satan. Theologians call it the proto-evangelion. I'll paraphrase it for you. It goes something like this. God speaking to Satan. He's like, okay, you've interfered here. All right. Well, I'm going to send my son to the world through the seed of a woman. You are going to bruise his heel. The heat is going to crush your head. Amen. Galatians chapter 4 and verse 4 says, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son, born of a virgin. Jesus steps onto the pages of human history. Do you understand, young man? Do you understand, young lady? This thing is not a fabricated fairy tale. This thing is not a myth. Jesus was a real historical person. He lived on this earth. He lived a sinless life. And then he took him and put him on a cross. And they butchered him on that cross. Why the cross? Why was he butchered on the cross? Because listen, we don't hang with God anymore. We hide from him. And God, out of his great love for us, like Colton was singing, he loves us. God wanted to restore that broken relationship. He wants us hanging with him again. And so you know what he did? To get us to hang with him again, he hung for us on a cross. And he didn't just die for you. He died as you. Amen. The Bible says that he who knew no sin became sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Jesus dies our death for us on the cross. They buried him. 3 days later, he rose from the dead. And because of what Jesus Christ did on that cross, and that's why New Song had that big cross up here. Why? Because it's a mark of power. Because of what Jesus did on the cross, you know what he did? He finished that unfinished work of Genesis chapter 3:15. And he ignominiously defeated the devil. And the Bible tells us in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 15 that because of the cross, Jesus disarmed the devil and he made a public spectacle of him on the cross. And anybody that will repent and believe in Jesus and what he did on the cross, there is no weapon formed against you that can ever prosper. Nothing. Repent and believe. He's our deliverer. But the big question tonight is this: will you let him deliver you? You let him deliver you. I'm going to ask every one of you to join me in a reverent posture of worship, and I want you to bow your head and close your eyes.